Okay, good morning to all of you. Let us begin the class on time. Those who will join, we will add them on later on. Let us begin. So like I said, today we are beginning the 10th and the last chapter in our book, which is the comparative development experiences of India and its neighbors. Okay, so we are on page 182 of your book. Look into your books. In the preceding units, we studied the developmental experience of India in detail. We also studied the kind of policies India adopted, which had varying impacts in different sectors. Over the last two decades or so, the economic transformation that is taking place in the different countries across the world, partly because of the process of globalization, has both short as well as long-term implications for each country, including India. Nations have been primarily trying to adopt various means which will strengthen their own domestic economies. To this effect, they are forming regional and global economic groupings, such as we have a group called the SAARC, the European Union, the ASEAN, G8, G20, BRICS, etc. What are these? These are small economic groups. They group themselves into small groups area wise, and this is how these names have come about. In addition, there is also an increasing eagerness on the parts of various nations to try on the parts of various nations to try and understand the developmental process pursued by their neighboring nations, as it allows them to better comprehend their own strengths and weakness. So we always look to our neighbors and the people around us, our neighboring countries. How are they doing? How are they doing economically? And if it is something good, then it is something which we would like to follow. Or if they had a problem while doing certain things, we are well aware of them. So you see, nations always look to their neighboring nations for better understanding, for increasing their strength, and also removing their weaknesses vis-a-vis their neighbors, along with their neighbors. In unfolding process of globalization, there is particularly considered essential by the developing countries as they face competition not only from the developed nations, but also amongst themselves in the relatively limited economic space enjoyed by the developing world. So now remember, children, we learnt about globalization, where the globe is the entire world, is the entire home for us. We just cannot isolate ourselves by saying, okay, we are in India, we don't know what's happening around the world. That would be not a very good thing to think of ourselves. We need to interact with each and every nation. We need to know what is happening and also what the developed nations are doing in the world, as well as area-wise, if you go Asia-wise, European-wise, and so on and so on. So globalization has brought about this big, drastic change in all the nations. They look towards their neighbors, very immediate, as well as the world, everyone who is there, every country that is there. They are a part of the world, and globalization has forced every country to think about their economic growth in relation to the remaining countries of the world, whether it is in their region or whether it is out of the region. They must know, and they do compete with the world as well as within their own regions. Like India would be competing within the Asian countries, India would be competing with the developed countries of the world. So you see, we are on a world platform. We must know where do we stand, how do we stand in relation to the economic growth and progress which we are making. So besides, an understanding of the other economies in our neighborhood is also required, as all major common economic activities in the region impinge on the overall human development in a shared environment. So by knowing what is happening in our neighborhood, okay, we can learn from them, avoid their weaknesses, avoid the problems they are facing, be aware. So he says it can impinge the overall human development in a shared economy if we understand the other economies in our neighborhood. Now in this chapter, what are we going to do? We will compare the developmental strategies pursued by India and the largest two of its neighboring economies, Pakistan and China. They are our immediate neighbors. It has to be remembered that despite being endowed with vast natural resources, there is little similarity between the political power set up in India, which is the largest democracy of the world, which is wedded to a secular and a deeply liberal constitution for more than half a century, for more than 50 years. And when we compare it with the militarist political power structure of Pakistan or the command economy of China, that has only recently started moving towards a democratic system and a more liberal economic restructuring respectively. So now let's look at it like this. We are three countries, India, Pakistan and China. What is our political setup? We are a democratic country. Okay, then we are the largest democracy in the world. We have a secular setup and we have a very liberal constitution. Compared with Pakistan, Pakistan most of its time had a militarist political power. China has a command economy where now they are beginning to move towards democracy and being more liberal. That is the first comparison we have done politically. Second, developmental path, a snapshot view. Do you know that India, Pakistan and China have many similarities in their developmental strategies? All the three nations have started towards their developmental part at the same time. While India and Pakistan became independent nations in 1947, the People's Republic of China was established in the year 1949. This is the second comparison. We got independence, India and Pakistan, in 1947. And China, they got their republic. They were established in the year 1949. In a speech at that time, Jawaharlal Nehru had said, "These new and revolutionary changes in China and India, even though they differ in their content, they symbolize the new spirit of Asia and a new vitality which is finding an expression in the countries in Asia." All the three countries had started planning their developmental strategies in similar ways. While India announced their first five-year plans for 1951 to 1956, Pakistan announced its first 5-year plans, which are now called the medium term plan. In 1956, China announced its first 5-year plans in 1953. Since 2013, Pakistan is working on the basis of the 11th 5-year developmental plan, which goes from 2013 to 18, whereas China is now working on its 13th 5-year plan from the year 2016 to 2020. Until March 2017, India has been following 5-year plans based development model. India and Pakistan adopted similar strategies, such as creating a large public sector and raising public expenditure on social development. Till the 1980s, all the three countries had similar growth rates. Right up to 1980, all the three countries had similar growth rates and per capita incomes. Where do they stand today in comparison to one another? Before we answer this question, let us trace the historical path of developmental policies in China and in Pakistan. After studying the last three units, we already know what policies India has been adopting since its independence. Now let us look at China. Up to 1980, all three countries were more or less the same, okay, with the same growth rate, same per capita income. Changes came about after 1980. What did China do? After the establishment of the People's Republic of China under a one-party rule, all the critical sectors of the economy, all the enterprises and all the lands owned and operated by the individuals were brought under the government control. The Great Leap Forward, GLF, campaign started in the year 1958. This is an important topic. The Great Leap Forward. It was initiated in the year 1958 by China, it was aimed at industrializing the country on a massive scale. Massive means big scale, huge scale. The people were encouraged to set up industries in their backyards. And in rural areas, communes were started. Under the commune system, the people collectively cultivated lands. So in 1958, there were around 26,000 communes covering almost all the farm population. So what is this commune system? People were divided into communities. They formed groups, okay, and they were given land. And they were told, now there's no land which belongs to you or me. We are giving you this land, it all belongs to the government. And you will now work on this land and produce your produce. So the GLF campaign met with many problems. There was a severe drought, drought is sukha, which caused a havoc in China, killing about 30 million people. Then when Russia had conflicts with China, it withdrew its professionals who had earlier been sent to China to help in the industrial process. In 1965, Mao introduced the Great Proletarian Cultural Revolution in the year 1966 to 76, period of 10 years. under which students and professionals were sent to work and learn from the countryside. They were sent into the villages, countryside, go work together, learn together. The present day fast industrial growth in China can be traced back to the reforms which were introduced in 1978. China introduced reforms in phases. In the initial phase, first stage, reforms were started in agriculture, foreign trade, and investment sectors. Now, in agriculture, for instance, commune lands were divided into small plots, which were allocated not only for use, not as an ownership, to an individual household. They were allowed to keep all the income from the land after paying a stipulated tax. A tax was told to them, see, this is the land given to this household, you use it. You are not the owner, you use it, you grow on it, and you will be paying the government a tax. Tax was stipulated, stated. Okay, then in the later phase, reforms were initiated in the industrial sector, private sector firms in general, and townships and village enterprises. Those enterprises which were owned and operated by the local collectives, in particular, they were allowed to produce the goods. At this stage, the enterprises owned by the government, known as the state-owned enterprises, SOEs, which we in India call public sector enterprises, were made to face competitions. The reform process also involved dual pricing. Dual means double pricing. This means fixing the prices in two ways. The farmers and the industrial units were required to buy and sell a fixed quantity of input and output on the basis of the prices which were fixed by the government, and the rest were purchased and sold in the at market price. This is the dual price system before. So amount was told, this much you have to buy and this much you have to sell to us. Us means here the government of China. After which, if you have anything more, you can sell it in the market at market prices. So this was a dual policy, pricing policy followed by China in the industrial reform. Over the years, as production increased, the proportion of goods or inputs transacted in the market also increased. So in order to attract foreign investors, special economic zones were set up by. So, talking of agricultural reforms, what did they do? Land was in the commune system. Commune system is where a plot of land was given to an individual household, not as ownership, but to use it, produce on that land. And then they were told a stipulated tax had to be paid to the government. After which, after you pay the tax, whatever is there is yours. You can use it. But this much of tax you have to pay to the government. Similarly, in the industrial sector, okay, what did they do? They followed a dual pricing policy. The dual pricing policy was, when you buy a certain amount of things you have to buy from us, product output also has to be sold to us. That was stipulated. After which, whatever is left, you could sell or buy the remaining from the open market and the open market prices. This was the dual pricing system adopted by China, and it was put into use in the industrial. This was about China. Let's look at Pakistan. While looking at various economic policies that Pakistan adopted, you will notice many similarities with India. Pakistan also followed a mixed economy, just like we do. They followed a mixed economy model with a coexistence of public and private sectors. In the late 1950s and the 1960s, Pakistan introduced a variety of regulated policy framework for import substitution based industrialization. What is import substitution? Import substitution simply means instead of importing goods from abroad, they would grow or manufacture those goods in their own country. That is, we are substituting imports with own manufacturing. So similarly, they regulated their policy framework for import substitution based industrialization. The policy combined tariff protection for manufacturing and consumer goods together with direct import controls on competing imports. So like India, their manufacturing goods were protected by giving them certain tax concessions, tariff protections, especially on consumer goods, and imports of goods were controlled by raising the taxes on those goods so that imports do not exceed exports. Because remember, when you are importing goods, what happens? You have to pay for it in foreign currency, right? The money goes out of the country. So that's why there is an import substitution. Instead of importing goods, why should we buy from out? Let us do the same thing in our own country. That is what import substitution normally means. So they also followed this policy. The introduction of the Green Revolution led to mechanization and increase in the public investment in infrastructure in select areas, which finally led to a rise in the production of food grains. So they also had a Green Revolution, so which led to a mechanization and increase in public investment. Public investment was increased, was given more importance, especially in agriculture, which resulted in the production of food grains. This changed the agrarian structure dramatically. In 1970s, nationalization of capital goods industries took place. Pakistan then shifted its policy orientation in the late 1970s and 1980s, when the major trust areas were denationalization and encouragement of private sectors. That is after the 70s and 80s. During this period, Pakistan also received financial support from the Western nations and remittances from continuously increasing outflow of emigrants in the Middle East. What does this mean? They were getting a lot of loans from Western nations, as well as a lot of foreign income was coming to the country. How? From the emigrants, those who had migrated and were working in the Middle East. They were sending that money back to Pakistan. Most of these migrants who had gone abroad and for maybe in search of work. Okay, so especially in the Middle East is these countries like Dubai, Saudi Arabia, all these countries, many of their people went over there. They were working and they were sending their remittances. Remittances mean money back to their country. This helped the country in stimulating economic growth. The then government also offered incentives to the private sectors. All this created a conducive climate for new investments, and in 1988, reforms were initiated in the country. Having studied a brief outline of the developmental strategies of China and Pakistan, let us now compare some of the developmental indicators of India, China, and Pakistan. The demographic indication. Now, if we look at the global population, out of every 6 persons living in this world, one is an Indian and another is a Chinese. We shall compare some demographic indicators of India, China, and Pakistan. The population of Pakistan is very small and accounts for roughly about 1/10 of China or India. So in comparison to India, Pakistan's population is less. If you compare the population of Pakistan with China, it is only 1/10. That is, out of 10 Chinese, you get 1 Pakistan. 1/10. The population of Pakistan is very small and accounts for roughly about 1/10 of China or India. Though China is the largest nation and geographically occupies the largest area among the 3 nations, its density is the lowest. Now China, if you remember, look at the map of China. It is much, much, much bigger than India and Pakistan. They are a big country, geographically. But when you talk of the density, the number of people living in a particular area, it is the lowest. Now the table shows, table 10.1 shows, the population growth as being the highest in Pakistan, followed by India, and then China. Scholars point out the one-child norm introduced in China in the late 1970s as a major reason for the low population growth. Ever since 1970, China adopted a one-child policy, and they strictly followed this. Today, they are the lowest density population. Okay. They also state that this measure led to a decline in the sex ratio. The proportion of females per 1,000 males. However, from the table, you will notice that the sex ratio is low and biased against females in all the 3 countries. Scholars cite some preference prevailing in all these countries as the reasons. The reason being, all the 3 countries prefer to have a male child as compared to a female child. In recent times, all 3 countries were adopting various measures to improve the situation. One child norm and the resultant arrest in the growth of population also have other implications. For instance, after a few decades in China, there will be more elderly people in proportion to young people. This led China to allow couples to have 2 children. So China followed their one child policy to such an extent that if second child was born, they were arrested. A one child norm and the resultant arrest in the growth of the population. They were so strict. Also have other implications, have other consequences. So now, so much so, we say that China now, after all these years, have more elderly population than all the 3 countries, because very few children have been born, allowed to be born over there. Now, this has allowed China to allow children, couples to have from 1 to 2 children. The fertility rate is also low in China and very high in Pakistan. Urbanization is high in China, with India having 33% of its people living in urban. We'll stop till here and we will begin, continue the next class, that is on Monday. Okay. Till then, children, all of you have a nice day, and be safe, stay safe. We'll meet on Monday, the next class.